Welcome to the Industry Angel Podcast. We hear from the best business minds across the globe. Entrepreneurs, social influencers, marketing mavens, and sales rock stars. We've got them all. Here comes your weekly dose of inspiration with your host, Ian Farrer.
Welcome to episode 90 of the Industry Angel. So we are getting super close to the 100th episode, and I think we need to celebrate it. You've all supported the show so well, and I need to acknowledge it. So if you've got any ideas, please tweet me or email me at the usual place, host@industryangel.com. And maybe we'll do a live. Do we do a live episode? I don't. We'll find out. Just drop me some ideas. I don't know what to do. So I was playing with some of the iTunes analytics yesterday, beta version, and I noticed there are a percentage of you who listen but haven't clicked the subscribe button. Why not? So to ensure you don't miss an episode, you're going to want to click it. So unless you aren't interested in killer content, of course, but make sure you subscribe. The show will just automatically download to your device. Thanks for leaving me a review lately. If you do, remember, take a screenshot and send me it via email, Twitter, LinkedIn, maybe, as I can't really correlate who's who. You know, reviewers such as CobraGirl82, don't tell us too much about the reviewer. Isn't that right, TractorBoy76? So make sure you let me know if you've left a review and I'll give you a shout out. Okay, let's hear from today's guest. Today we have a returning friend of the show from episode 007. Welcome back to the Industry Angel, Jamie Hill.
Hi Ian, thanks for having me on the show, appreciate it.
007,
just,
eh?
Though I know, I think myself as a bit of a James Bond, so
I know you do.
I can revel in that now, 007. Am I the first returning guest, or can I not take that claim to fame?
You cannot take that. If you'd been here 3 weeks ago, brother, you would have been the first returning guest.
Oh, 3 weeks out, see? Might have had my schedule better when I first said about this a few weeks ago. I could have had that mantle.
Well, if you weren't so busy,
yeah, you know, that's it.
With your spy work.
Yeah, secret Facebook groups and whatnot, yeah.
Exactly.
So, well, thank you for having me back on the show anyway. Thank you very much.
That's fine. It's been so long, man. But I think for the people who mightn't have heard 007, why don't you give them a little 1 minute about you and Hill Shipping?
Yeah, my name's Jamie Hill. We're a family-run business, Hill Shipping. We primarily ship cars and motorbikes and personal effects all around the world. And we're currently in our 23rd year of trading, and things keep, touch wood, getting better and better.
Brilliant. I couldn't have said it any better. Fantastic. How many years was that? Did you say that?
Into our 23rd now.
23rd. Ooh, yeah. What are you going to do for 25?
Well, I'm all worried about approaching 40 next year, so I'll get to that point first.
what do you mean, approaching 40?
Well, I'm 39 now, so 40.
I thought you must have been about 46, 47.
Yeah, I've aged since the last podcast.
Don't worry about it. 40's amazing, man. You'll have a right hoot.
Yeah, so I'm told. It should be good fun.
It's good. It's good. So, yeah, so nearly 25 years in the shipping industry. So, but today, Jamie, what are you going to talk to us about?
Okay, so recently we've been exploring how to get more work through Facebook. I've had a very basic approach that's worked for us, so I'm pretty sure that it can work for anybody else. Just basically spending time on there, working hard on the platform and seeing business come in through a little bit of advertising, but not spending a lot of money and really delving deep into the groups in Facebook and spending time on there and reaping rewards through word of mouth and people basically realizing what you do without selling your business. So just being helpful, communicating and get involved in the communities.
Excellent stuff. So Is this creating content as well, Jamie, or is this really just, as Zuckerberg would say, meaningful engagement?
More meaningful engagement, especially with the groups, because with the groups, you can only go on as an individual and not through your business. So that side of it is very different to the business page side of it. So for any business that's out there, first thing you want to do is create a Facebook page, and it's very easy to do. Think of it like a mini website. And the content I'm putting on there is basically because we ship cars, and each car we get, we have surveyed. So we always get pictures of it and good photos. So straight away, I've got content that I can put on the page every day, all day long, for 1 or 2, 7 days a week. Where the groups, it really is a case of just jumping in, helping people understand sometimes the process of importing a car, not even mentioning our company name, talking them through stuff, jumping in to do with like transport quotes and things like that. You could just run with a lot of things just to help people sort of understand the process of bringing a car into this country. So that's worked pretty well. And every now and again, I just put a photo on of a car we've shipped. I've run a couple of competitions on there recently, and the feedback from that's been brilliant. So the business page side to the actual community side is two different aspects, two different beasts altogether, really.
You know, when you put content on the Facebook page, Jamie, are you looking for likes to the page?
Yeah.
Is that what ultimate goal is, to get more people to like your page?
Yeah, on the business page, we're just looking for nice organic growth. Obviously, there's a lot of interest in cars in general. So if we put up a picture of a Ford Mustang, get a little bit of interaction on that. And then occasionally it will say, this post is doing well, you can boost it. And then we'll boost it a little bit further. So we find once you get that boost, you can then sort of delve a bit deeper into the statistics of it as well. And you can see the organic reach and the actual global reach of the whole thing. And you can watch the numbers grow. And it's quite fascinating if you run it for like 7 to 14 days, how much that will spread around the world for such a small amount of money per boost or per ad. It's quite incredible from what we were spending on advertising in magazines to what we're now spending on a Facebook run. The difference is phenomenal.
It's interesting. So I guess your avatar, you know, your ideal customer, they could be anywhere in the world, Jamie. They just could reach out to you via the internet, and then you would just sorted out A to B?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. So if a guy's got a car in America that he wants to, we have clients in America who are looking to ship a car from the UK. Before, that would be a little bit harder for them to find, but we're finding they're now approaching us on Facebook. We're probably getting more inquiries through the Facebook side of it than any other part of our advertising streams now. So, like I said, anyone around the world now is more likely to find us on Facebook as opposed to finding our website even. So we're finding that is definitely working well.
Is it hard then to niche on this, because you might be looking for, so you could be looking for a guy 18 to 35 based in Washington, D.C. who earns this amount of money. You must have loads of avatars, because anybody could ship a car, though.
Yeah, well, this is the beauty of the groups. So we're finding, obviously, the Facebook page has had some really good growth over the last sort of 6 to 10 months. But with the groups, so, for example, we ship a lot of American cars. So obviously, after doing a little bit of research, there's a UK American car group. So this group's pretty hardcore. They all love their American cars. And that group alone has recently just approached 20,000 people in this one group. So there's all people in this country who own an American car or who are looking to buy an American car. So just through going onto that one group, I know now that I can reach 20,000 people who are interested in American cars, which is a big part of our business, shipping them in from America. So before, we could do a magazine run, and I'd pretty much guarantee that you'd get nowhere near that many people looking at what you're putting out there. And we can get a lot of feedback from that. And I've also run some competitions on those groups where I've asked the guys to put on pictures of their car. And once a month now, we're going to pick a winner to have them as a car of the month on our Facebook page, website, and on an advert we run in Classic America magazine.
I
actually lost count. I think I had about 800 people enter that competition.
You're joking.
Yeah, it was phenomenal, honestly. The feedback was amazing. And it was all positive. Nobody jumped in with anything bad, like, oh, you're just for promotion. Or, you know, the winner we picked out, we hadn't even shipped his car, didn't know who the guy was. But we say, you know, and for the winner as well, we gave them a year's free subscription to Classic American magazine as well.
Well done. So, that's cool.
Yeah. So it's all good. It's all for the spirit of, you know, people who like American cars. And we're finding that type of approach about selling absolutely anything is working really, really well for us.
Yeah, no, that sounds really good. So where was that? Sorry, was that in a Facebook group you did that?
Yeah, that was in a Facebook group. That was UK American car owners. And like I say, the numbers there. But that approach would basically work for anyone. I mean, you know, if you was like a dog groomer, not just concentrating your Facebook page, if once you start looking into it, there's a Facebook group for every single breed of dog, pretty much. So you could go on to the group, get involved in chats, and before you know it, you're speaking to thousands and thousands of people who basically could be a potential client. And again, for someone who had a travel agent, you know, every place in the world has pretty much got their own board or community for you to get involved with.
So thinking about that Facebook group, sort of meaningful interactions then. How long do you spend on Facebook groups? Does your missus go crazy with you because you're constantly sitting on Facebook talking about cars?
No, to be honest with you, it's pretty limited. I go on just once or twice a day. That's all I find you need to do. There's two or three that I've now narrowed it down to. There's another one for Land Rover owners. That's got 60,000 members on that group because we ship a lot of Land Rover cars as well. And there's also a Mini one for Mini enthusiasts. So they're the three that I just spend the most time on and concentrate on. And I'd like two or three times a day, just hop onto the group, see what people were chatting about, and sort of try and get involved with the you know, the conversation and be part of the community.
And then have you got a group yourself, Jamie, for your business?
No, that is something I've been thinking about lately, but I didn't want to try and take people from the other groups and cause upset for the sake of trying to build up something that might benefit us in the short term, where these groups have got such established sort of followings already. It's probably easier for the moment just to piggyback on them to speak to people. Mm. And where we ship quite a wide range of vehicles and motorbikes, it'd be quite hard to niche down,
yeah,
to just have people talk about cars in general. I mean, yeah, I think the approach of piggybacking on the other groups would work better as opposed to trying to niche down on your own group.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I always worry about starting from ground zero as well, because obviously with these groups now, there's tens of thousands of people in them already, whereas starting from zero would be really tough.
I think so. Yeah, I've seen one or two others that have tried to start their own groups. I think any car groups are it can be a lot of bickering that goes on. And I've seen one or two try to break away and start their own, and it's fallen flat. So I don't think the appeal is there. I think you're best off letting others do the hard work and the groundwork, which takes a long time to build up, and just use your expertise to help others, and then hopefully reap some work back and rewards from that down the line.
Yeah, definitely. I think you'll get referrals as well. Surely if someone's asking a question about something, they'll point at you and say, oh, actually, Jamie knows all about this, or I used Jamie for that. He was really good. It's got to count for something, yeah?
Yeah, that's definitely happened quite a lot. I mean, a lot of our work was, you know, word of mouth before, and I think even more so now with the with this approach through Facebook. A lot of people were just recommending us straight away. If someone says, "Oh, looking to ship a car from America, thinking of actually, you know, jumping in and buying one," any suggestions? And my name will come up all the time now, so it's working well.
So what about any other social channels there? Because I'm concerned about, you know, building your house on someone else's land sort of thing, and putting all the eggs in the Facebook basket. Do you think about that? Have you got any other irons in the fire and like social channels?
Well, I've been sort of using Instagram as well, but as with everything, I know everyone says you've now got to be on social media, which I totally agree with 110%. But I think there's only so much you can do in a day. So I totally agree with you as well when you say about putting all your eggs in one basket. But I think the approach, if you're going to learn something, you know, off your own back. You have to spend time on that one platform, really, to try and get to grips with it. I think once you get more established, more confident, you'll actually spend less time on there because you figure out what works and what doesn't, and then you can move on to the next platform. Instagram, I've been doing that very slowly, building up a little bit of a following. Feedback's been pretty good. Got a couple of jobs out of it, so that's been quite rewarding in that sense for the time I've spent on there. But I think once the Facebook page is running better than what it is now, maybe in 6 months to a year's time, I'd probably then look to hop on to somewhere else and put different content onto there and then try and build that up. So then eventually you've got two or three social channels where you've got a constant stream of community awareness on there, and then you haven't got to worry too much about one particular platform in case something went wrong in that area.
Yeah, it's interesting when I run my sort of digital courses once a month, what I talk about is actually picking a couple of platforms and just bossing it. So rather than be everywhere and just diluting what effort you can put in, you know, just really double down on a couple. So like you've done there, Instagram and Facebook. But I've noticed you do stuff on LinkedIn as well. So how does that fare for you then?
I've been spending less time on there lately purely because of the Facebook thing. But I find the actual community itself on LinkedIn is really good. I think the groups on there are probably very underestimated. But they're not as specific niche-wise as Facebook. I just think the Facebook platform just seems to, as much as what people moan about it and everything else, I think you either go with it or you just lose out. And I just think, as with, you know, people say, the dinosaurs, things change. And if you don't move with it, you just end up losing. And I think that's what I've learned as I've got older as well. But LinkedIn, I would say definitely. And I know that you're a big user of LinkedIn because I always see your content on there. And I think you get involved really well, I think, on conversation on there. And I'd imagine that works for you, well for you, Ian.
Yeah, LinkedIn's probably my number one. I think, well, it is for B2B.
Oh, really?
Anyway, yeah, definitely, mate. Yeah, you know, B2B, it's where it's at for me on LinkedIn. And just the networking side of it and keeping your brand really high, I think. And you've probably seen a bit me doing a lot more video of lately. You know, I think video works really well now. See, I'm not like you, Jamie. I haven't got a really super sexy sort of tangible product. I know it's not your product, it's someone else's, but you've got something to show, like an amazing Mustang or something like that, where, you know, I've got nothing. It's just so you've got to try and create some content out of your own kind of value, you know?
Yeah, definitely. And I think that's when you've got to really bring value to the table in that sense as well. I mean, we're quite lucky because obviously once we get a car surveyed, we've got pictures, we've got content which has already been created. So we can put that on and there'll be plenty of likes and comments because in the niches we're in, there'll be people who like that particular type of make and model of car from that era, especially with a lot of the cars we do are classic. So we've always got that type of following. But I think, like you say, if you haven't got a physical product per se to sell, you really need to bring value. But you do with this fantastic podcast and obviously your Fireside Chats.
There you go, £10 in the post for you, brother.
Which you can watch on Facebook. Yeah, that's it. So.
Good man. It's funny because I don't really do much on Facebook, to be honest. It's I don't know. What do you think about UK to US? I think the US do Facebook a lot better than us. Do you find that?
Yeah, I think so. I think they're probably more confident in two ways, behind a camera and behind a microphone. So I think their approach is very different to people in this country. I think they're not, maybe not the shy, I don't know. But I think they're more used to being selling themselves. They're more confident in that respect. And I think you get used to it, though. I mean, I'll imagine when you first started doing your podcast, you was very bit apprehensive, a bit nervous, and now it's probably second nature to you, you know?
Yeah, 007 to episode 90 is very different.
Yes, that's it. And I think that comes with it. And that really is what's happened with us and Facebook. You're worried about the content you're putting on and you're worried about what people might say, but you just got to go with it. And I think with the business pages, the one tip I'd give everyone is once you've built your page, add the review section to it, you know, and if you get bad feedback, suck it up, learn from it and adjust your business because that's life, you know, and a lot of our competitors don't have the review section on their page at all, whereas we've got it and we look to build it up. And if you get someone who's saying something that's negative, which touch wood hasn't happened so far, then you got to learn from that and try and change your business to perhaps suit your customers' needs better. And I think that's just the reality of life. And if you get good feedback, roll with it. If you get bad feedback, roll with that as well. But I think it's important because it looks authentic. And I think that's what people want to see when they're looking at a business page. They want to see authentic, genuine reviews and feedback.
Yeah, definitely. I think they want to see you as well as a person, Jamie. Do you know, like the humanization bit? You know, I mentioned some of the stuff I do on video. It's because they're interested and they want to know who you are. And even for me, when I go onto a website, first page I go on, about us.
Yeah, definitely.
I want to know who they are, what they're about. If there's any photographs, great. So reviews for me, 100%, because you get to know the real people, you get to know the customers, and it's so valuable. You raise a good point.
Yeah, definitely. I think on the reviews, people tend to be dealing with one particular person from the business during that job. So they put that person's name on, and it creates a bit of, you know, especially with ours, like being a family-run business, it just creates that bit of extra special, you can approach, you feel approachable, you know, and that's what we're trying to build.
What do you think about so your Facebook page, trying to get the likes on that? Are you really concentrating on that? Are you more so just staying in groups, and then do you try to push them to your page?
Yeah, well, the likes itself, I'd rather have one genuine like as opposed to, you know, 200-300 people just clicking and liking for no reason. Okay. So I'm not overly worried about that. I'm worried about getting content on there and then people getting engaged with that content. And then on the groups, with the competitions we run, well, I said earlier, we had like 800 people enter that competition. We noticed just from that how many more people jumped on to our Facebook page. You can link the two together without being sort of, you can be discreet in your approach on how you do it. And then all of a sudden, you've got a lot more eyes on your business than what you had, you know, at the start of the week, and just through running one small giveaway.
And then what do you do with it? Do you reach out to the moderator of the group and say, is it okay if I run a competition?
Yeah. I mean, more often than not, you can just, they're very open. As long as you're not selling your business overly, they're fine with it. If you're doing a giveaway, it's not a problem at all. But most mods are quite hot. If there was a problem, they'd come on to you and ask you to, you know, delete the post or what have you, or just change it. But I haven't had that so far. Every group I've been on have been brilliant. The mods have been brilliant. And I think, again, as long as you're not sell, they won't have the or it's a phrase that you're like, Ian, is a jab, jab, right hook, isn't it?
Or Gary's phrase.
Yeah.
So,
and I think it's true. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, definitely. Just think about your business though, Jamie. So it's a 23-year-old business. What, your parents started or?
My uncle. He's there, and it's actually it's his business. Mm-hmm. So it's family run in that sense. So we're just looking to keep growing it, keep it, you know, family run. So I think what people have learned is that when people ship with us, as opposed to using one of the big shipping lines, you can speak to people, as opposed to speaking to, I don't know how many people in offices wherever now. We're dealing with one company in particular now, and they've just moved their accounts to Bolivia. I mean, to get answers for these big companies now, it's getting harder, and that's always our angle. We want to be approachable. You can pick up the phone, speak to us. You can message us on Facebook late at night, and you'll get an answer. And I just don't think a lot of companies realize that now, and they're losing touch.
So how does your uncle think about this? And so things have gone very digital now. You're doing a lot of effort on Facebook. Is he still old school and saying, Jamie, stop wasting your time on that, or is he all over it?
He's all for it. He lets me sort of get on with it, and we, you know, just have, you know, we have little chats about what's going on, but he sees the results, so he's more than happy with it. I'd say it's pretty new to us in that respect, as we've gone from print to digital. But from spending, I'd say about, it's not a lot of money I've spent so far at all. I mean, we'd spend a lot more on this per month in per magazine advertising. If you're looking for one advert, we'd probably spend about £500-600 through Facebook. I think I've probably spent about £300 so far, and I've probably cleared about £20,000 profit. So,
hey, good man. Thanks for the numbers. Love it.
Well, yeah, you know, people don't often give them, but I think so. You know, it's, I don't think it's a case then of thinking, oh, let's spend 3,000 and then get it to, you know, X amount more. I think you just got to keep seeing what works, what doesn't work, and then sort of invest in a little bit more as you go along.
Yeah, love that. So thinking about those traditional methods then that your uncle might be interested in, what does that die a death, or is that still going as well? So do you guys do the network, and do you still put adverts in? Do you use mail? Are you trying to pick people up on your email list to your website as well?
We've still kept a couple of the magazines going because they're like Bibles, okay. One or two of them. So we know that we'll always get our name in there, and we'll get work from that. So we know that works. So we probably wouldn't change that for a very long time, if ever. But what we've seen is that the magazines themselves are starting to push to more digital. So you can now, just instead of, you know, buying the magazine, you can now download it. So in the next 5 to 10 years, how many more magazines are going to be left? You might not have a choice. You might not be advertising in a magazine in 5, 10 years' time. It might be just downloading onto an iPad through an app.
Yeah, yeah, I'm seeing that as well. There's a business magazine up here in the Northeast, which is just launched its last paper hard copy, which is, I think it's a shame actually. I quite like a magazine.
Yeah. I totally agree. I think it is, and it is bit really an end of an era in that sense. I think it's good that you can pick up a mag or a newspaper and read through it, read articles that you necessarily wouldn't read anywhere else. So I think that's lost in the future. I think it'd be a shame, but you know, you either go with it, I said earlier, or you lose out. Yeah. That's the problem with it, you know.
So I'm interested, one more bit, I'm interested in your website. So I really don't want to say GDPR, but I just did. So thinking about you on Facebook, do you push them to your website? Do you have some sort of lead magnet where you can grab their email address from your website?
To be honest with you, no, we don't. I think it's getting to a point, and I know people recently who have started new businesses and they haven't even bothered creating websites. Yeah. They just had a Facebook page. Yeah. And I think we know if someone's got an inquiry now, they're going to either send us an email through the contact form on the website, or they're going to message us through Facebook. And that's the two main ways that we're getting contacted. And that's through all ages, where before, I think the older generation might have picked up the phone. It's the amount of phone calls we get now compared to what we used to get has dramatically declined. About the amount of emails and messages we get has increased also dramatically.
I love that. That's really interesting. So actually what we're seeing is there that you might actually need to invest in a website because your Facebook page will just do it all for you.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. I think that's definitely what I'm seeing, just through friends as well that have created businesses. They're saying, you know, why have both? What's what are you going to get from having the two? SEO is changing all the time.
Yeah.
And I don't think the average Joe Blogs overly understands it. It takes a very, very long time to build up good SEO on your website. Keep creating that content, and hopefully Google, you know, will pick it up. But it's talking a long, long time. Whereas if you're lucky enough to have something go viral on Facebook, fantastic. If not, you just get involved in them groups, work hard every single day, and hopefully get some more eyes on your page that are meaningful, instead of just getting browsers coming along and not sort of paying any attention to your site in general. Yeah, so in conclusion, basically, I'd recommend from, you know, small businesses to big businesses, look at what you're currently spending your advertising money on and where you're spending it, and perhaps try and invest not just money into Facebook for your Facebook page and adverts, but also invest time on Facebook through groups, and try and be active, be part of the community. Try and pass some, you know, good free information on to people who are interested in, you know, what services you might be able to offer, and see if you can get some work that way, and try and build up a good reputation and some more work for yourselves.
Yeah, I love that. I think people might be a bit nervous about that, you know, in case they feel like it's not going to lead to anything, but I guess you just have to take the leap of faith and go for it.
Yeah, I think it's just the new age equivalent of being a salesman. Instead of going door to door, you know, just go group to group and see what pans out for yourself. But, you know, worst case scenario is you don't get anything from it. But I would be very, very confident it would work for, you know, 99% of businesses And I do think that they will reap some rewards from the effort and the time that they put in. Just got to work hard, definitely.
Great. So that's a great place to leave it. So that's the new door to door, group to group. I love it, mate. Well done.
Group to group.
Well, thanks so much for the update, Jim. I'm really pleased that things are going well for you as well. So there you go, 007. We're now possibly maybe 090. I don't know what we're going to be.
Well, thank you for having me on again, Ian. I really do appreciate it.
Thanks to Jamie Bond Hill there for joining us again. You may remember that Facebook reported negative user growth in North America for the first time in Q4 2017 last year. So in response, Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg, he announced earlier this year that the newsfeed algorithm would shift its focus. If you remember, it was all about serving relevant content, creating more meaningful social interactions. So with that change in algorithm, Facebook's prioritized these kind of personal moments that connect people with communities. So, and hopefully it's going to provide an improvement in the user experience and obviously to drive user growth. Because remember, we've had that hashtag, what was it again? Delete Facebook or something. So I think Jamie raises a great point at the end there. You know, rather than door-to-door selling, it's group-to-group. I love that. And you've just got to put the time in. I think the one thing that might put people off is that patience to play the long game in these groups. Of course, there's specific niche groups where your audience hang. So why not be there? Think about it like networking. Remember last week's show, we talked about networking. Maybe think about it like that. Put some time in to hang out in these groups. And I do think this kind of value can be offered outside of Facebook as well. This is what I personally look to live by. Help others, offer killer content, give free value. Just like this podcast, it's free for you. Hopefully entertains and it educates. And I just love this community and your support is amazing. So for me, just create content, do the right thing. You know, karma's great, it'll just come back. And I think today's homework is to find a great piece of content and reply or message the author and tell them why you enjoyed it. You know, they love hearing from you. It's a bit lonely sometimes. You know, I'm at the moment on the road again. I'm in a hotel. I'm trying to get this out this week for you. And I don't know who's at the other end. I don't know who's listening. And there's lots of other people who write content, create some great social live videos and this kind of stuff. They're really giving it big licks and creating some awesome stuff. So if you have absorbed this content, if you've consumed it and you loved it, this is the homework. Drop them a line, reach out, tell them why you liked it. They're going to love hearing from you. And who knows where it'll lead. You know, you might end up creating a great relationship with somebody because you reached out and told them how the content resonated with you. So get off the fence, Angel Nation. Spread your wings. Show some love. So until next time, I'm Ian Farrer. This is the Industry Angel, and thanks for listening.